and thanks so much for being here. Amazing to see so many of you here tonight. Brings me enormous joy to share this project with you tonight. This piece began its life in Canberra when I premiered it at the National Gallery as part of the Canberra International Music Festival in May. And sort of in between rehearsals, I overheard a conversation in the corners that there was a piano joke going in Canberra at the ANU School of Music. And
yeah.
Here I am. So it's quite a ways to come full circle. Just a few words about the project, the work. Essentially, it's a 60-minute journey through modern history, through the prism of arts and politics, and the way the often fraught and complex relationships between the two shape our culture and our society. As we all know, politicians and artists often overlap. Artists often concern themselves with plans to change our society and the way that we live, and politicians often rehearse and hone their parliamentary performances and see themselves as architects of public life. This piece consists of 18 vocal portraits that are based on the recorded speeches and interviews of some of the most iconic creative and political figures of our time. Rob Davidson, the composer of this piece, uses what he calls speech portraiture or voice portraiture, where the music often traces and sometimes with uncanny precision the speech patterns of the voice, the inflection, the rhythm. So you will hear that. So sit back and I hope you enjoy the ride. Thank you.
Thank you.
country and do not want to enter in any legal argument, so I will answer your question fully as well I can. I was not a member or am not a member of any communist party.
You have never been a member of the Communist Party. That is correct. Wei Wei, young man of 71 years old. Wei Wei, young man of 71 years old. Have built my first house at the edge.
Yeah. an idea in the whole thing? If I did, where's the idea, huh? What's the idea?
The idea is obviously, it would seem to me, that a lot of people want to live together, as you point out, to make their livings, to make money, to enjoy what this large city has to offer. And I get from time immemorial, people have flocked more or less to one spot to exchange ideas as well.
But my dear Mark, there was a justification for that. When there was no other means of communication than by personal contact, that's why the plan for this city here to begin now originated. It originated back there in the Middle Ages, when the only way you could have culture, the only way you could get social distinction or any education from it was by getting up. I would like to make it appropriate.
General, And his symphony orchestra gave us Percy Grainger's Early One Morning, and now back to Percy Grainger himself, our guest today on Favorites of the Famous. Mr. Grainger, you've been called the one cheerful, sunny composer living. To what would you attribute your the warmth and the naturalness of your music?
And screaming its implication, and that's a very hard one. draft all drives from screaming. I think the best thing for a composer is to have badly treated in every way.
A composer to be badly treated in every way was just a coach. During Stalin's purges, when disobedience often meant death or the Gulag, government decree dictated what was good art, acceptable art. Stalin attended Shostakovich's opera Lady Macbeth of the Bzhenk district on 26 January 1936 in Moscow. The next day, the state's newspaper crowned as editorial condemned Shostakovich's music as anti-Soviet ugliness. The ability of good music to enthrall the masses at rest has been sacrificed on the altar of petit bourgeois formalism. This is playing at abstruseness, and such games can only finish badly. Shostakovich feared for his life. His opera was immediately withdrawn, and he never composed another. One of Shostakovich's staunchest defenders was his friend, the pianist Maria Yudina. Many of her closest friends lost to the Gulag labor camps or worse. Yudina was defiant to the core, bearing her cross very visibly, championing the most adventurous blacklisted works, and reading banned poets like Boris Pasternak and Nikolai Zabolotsky in her concerts. But she was Stalin's favorite pianist. Final years, Stalin didn't let anyone to see him for days at a time. He listened to the radio a lot. Once he called the radio committee where the administration was and asked if they had a record of Mozart's piano concerto number 23, which had been heard on the radio the day before, played by Yudina Gillard. They told him that of course they had. Actually, there was no record. The concert had been long. But they were too afraid to say no.
Most important lesson нашей партии 1917 году. И после того, как партия предприняла реальные меры по ликвидации капиталистического помещичьего гнета, представители братских партий, восхищаясь отвагой и успехами нашей партии, присвоили ей звание главной бригады мирового революционного и рабочего движения.
demanded that they send the recording to his duchy. The committee panicked, but they had to do something. They called Yudina and an orchestra and recorded that night. Everyone was shaking his fright, except for Yudina, naturally. Yudina later told me that they had to send the conductor home. He was so scared he couldn't think. They called in another conductor who trembled and got everything mixed up, confusing the orchestra. Only the third conductor was in any shape to finish the recording. Anyway, the record was ready by morning. They made one single copy and sent it. They say that her recording of Mozart was on the record player when the leader and teacher was found dead in his dungeon. It was the last thing he had listened to.
smelling the sweet grass of distant hills, too steep to climb, too far to see in this handful of water, scooped from the river dam, touching the sky, where like a single wing my hand dips through clouds, tasting the shadow of basket walls, the color of ferns, a perch, spoon color, climbs where the moon sank, trailing bubbles of white, and school kids on picnics swing from a rope.
Mir höher anrechnen werden als meine Geschichtenbücher. und die euch durch tausend Untaten in ein unvorstellbares Verderben führen. Ich kannte sie. Ich wusste, dass nichts als Katastrophen und Elend für Deutschland und für Europa aus ihrem unsäglich niederträchtigen Wesen erwachsen konnten, während die Mehrzahl von euch in heute gewiss von für euch selbst unfassbarer Verblendung sich für die Götter von Ordnung, Schönheit und nationaler Würde hielt. Katastrophen und Elend.
Meanings. precisely bad and it's precisely good. But you, in painting, it's just, you know, there's this, it's not the same at all. You get painting either as meaning for a lot of people, no meaning for other people, awful for some, rotten for others. So you'll never get it right.
Mr. Parkey, tell us how Monarch came into being.
It didn't jump out of the blue. It's part of a long tradition, beginning back with Suzanne up through the Cubists, mostly with to painting being done today.
Well, it's definitely a product of evolution.
Yeah, it didn't jump out of the blue. It's part of a long tradition, beginning back with Suzanne,
up through the Cubists, post-Cubists,
to
painting
being done today.
Well, it's definitely a product of evolution.
Yes.
Can we go back to this method question, which so many people think is important? Can you tell us how you developed your method of painting, and why you paint as you do?
Well, method is made a natural growth out of a need. And from the need, why an artist has found new ways of expressing the world about him. I happen to find ways that are different from the usual techniques of painting, which seems a little strange at the moment. I don't think there's anything very different about it. Modern artist, it seems to me, is working and expressing an inner world. Modern artist, it seems to me, is working and expressing an inner world. In other words, expressing the
Sure.
Your Twitter account has several disparaging comments about women's looks.
You once told the contestant on Celebrity Apprentice it would be a pretty picture to see her on her knees. Does that sound to you like the temperament of a man who should elect as president? And how will you answer the charge from Hillary Clinton, who is likely to be the Democratic nominee, that you are part of the war on women? You are part of the war on women. 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 You are part of the war on women.
I think the big problem this country has is being politically correct. I think the big problem this country has is being politically correct. I've been challenged by so many people, and I don't frankly have time for total political correctness. Total political correctness. Total political correctness. Total political correctness. And frankly, what I say, and oftentimes it's fun, it's kidding, we have a good time. What I say is what I say.
Thank you. from him. Now looking at his watch, because apparently a woman's spoken too long, I've had him yell at me to shut up in the past. But I will take the remaining, I will take the remaining seconds of my speaking time to say to the Leader of the Opposition, I think the best course for him is to reflect on the standards he's exhibited in public life. And the Leader of the Opposition should think seriously about the role of women in public life and in Australian society, because we are entitled to a better standard than this. Yeah.
I am Robert Helpmann, Artistic Director of the Australian Ballet. I am concerned with ballet and theatre in all its forms. I am Robert Helpmann, Artistic Director of the Australian Ballet. I am concerned with ballet and theatre in all its forms. I am Robert Helpmann, Artistic Director of the Australian Ballet. I am concerned with ballet and theatre in all its forms. I am concerned with ballet and theatre in all its forms. Even as a child, I was always dressing up. From the earliest time I can remember, because my mother used to recite Shakespeare to me when I was in my cot and I had to go to bed, and she would read Romeo and Juliet, and then of course I wouldn't let her read Romeo and Juliet because I realised that Juliet was the best part, so I used to read Juliet to her. And my father was a little bemused by all this because he was a stock and station man, and it was a little surprising to him to see his son, his at that time his only son, parading around the house dressed in whatever came into my fancy. And he went on a business trip to Melbourne when I was 14, and when he came back he said, "You're always wanting to be a dancer, and there's a girl dancing in Melbourne, and she's got a company, and I've been to see her, and she's going to take you into the company." And next week I left for Melbourne with my mother, and the girl was Anna Pavlova. By the time it dawned on me to try and ask why and how he got into her dressing room and why she took me as a student, both my father and Pavlova had died. I am Robert Helpmann, Artistic Director of the Australian Ballet. I am concerned with ballet and theatre in all its forms. I am concerned with ballet and theatre in all its forms. I'm always asked what was the most memorable thing, or the most performance or production, or, and it's impossible really for me to say, because so many things have been memorable to me. My first appearances with Markova, my first appearances with Fontaine, my first appearances with Vivian Lee, and the first time I played Hamlet, all of them. I have a mind that is, it's very difficult to explain, that success means nothing to me. Something else.